Stephanie Senna, and I'm grateful to be here with you today. I am a professor at Villanova University. Excuse me. I started off in the history department in 2003, and I did my first postgraduate degree at Villanova in history. And after teaching in the history department for a few years, I moved over to a department at Villanova called the Center for Peace and Justice, where I would teach courses on poverty and homelessness in the Center for Peace and Justice. And in 2010, I opened up a homeless shelter in Philadelphia with my college students. We were operating in church basements. And I started it with my Villanova students, but very soon after I started the initiative, other universities throughout Philadelphia started to call me and ask if they could also be involved. So Penn was the next university, and then Drexel, Temple, PCOM, Swarthmore. And so we built out chapters at all these local universities. And we would operate in basements of churches, such as we were at Old First Church at 4th and Race, and we were at Arch Street United Methodist Church for a little while. We were at another church at 21st and Fairmount, another one at Arch and 18th. So we would operate in church basements. We were, Project Home would do most of our intake, and we were largely for a while a men's shelter, although we did run for 1 year a shelter for LGBTQ youth who were aged out of the foster system. Otherwise, we were mostly sheltering in single men, and we would help link them to services throughout Philadelphia and work with them to get housing. But that was, in 2010, it was significantly easier for people in Philadelphia to access housing for a bunch of reasons, but we, in 2010, we had more housing vouchers than we have now in Philadelphia, and also public housing units. So in 2012, that is when Congress passed an act called RAD, which allowed for public housing to be privatized. And so a lot of public housing units were sold to private developers who then fixed them up and flipped them and sold them for a large profit. So developers were starting to gentrify huge parts of Philadelphia. And then all of these public housing units came off inventory. And so in 2013, the Philadelphia Housing Authority closed its wait list with about 40,000 people on the wait list for housing, and the wait list has not opened back up. So when we started in 2010, there were many more housing options, including public housing. And then that ended up going away in 2012, after this act from Congress, although for decades, public housing has been defunded. And so there was already a problem before that. But then when Mayor Kenney came to office in Philadelphia, the rest of the housing vouchers that were accessible went away also. So there were very few housing vouchers after he came to office. So it just became much harder to get people who were in our shelter into housing. And we started to recognize that shelters, if there's no housing, became permanent. And that really you solve homelessness by increasing the inventory of affordable housing. So when we opened our doors in 2010, the largest men's homeless shelter was closing its doors. That was Ridge Shelter. And so that, therefore, there was like a decrease of over 300 shelter beds in the city when Ridge closed. So that became when we opened in 2010, there was more of a need for homeless shelter beds. But now we believe that there is more of a need to increase housing and not shelter, because if housing is not increased, then again, the shelter becomes permanent. So we ran the shelter for about a you know, almost a decade, about a decade. And then we moved somewhere about 750 single men from homelessness to housing. And that was through, you know, linking them with various services in Philadelphia, offering them services in our shelter, and then also working with them to get housing on the back end. So then a couple years ago, we decided that we were going to try to fill some of the gaps in Philadelphia, including most shelters do not accept humans and pets together. And so if a human and a pet become homeless, the human's pet has to go into a pet shelter in order for the human to go into a human shelter. And the biggest pet shelter in Philadelphia is ACT. And there's a very high rate of animal euthanasia in that shelter because it's overcrowded and there's just too many animals. Many of them are homeless because their owners became homeless. So we wanted to fill that gap and work to create a living situation for people who are exiting homelessness where they can keep their pets with them. We also realized that we wanted to work on housing and not just housing affordability, but increasing access to housing, because in Philadelphia there is a lack of affordable housing, but even the affordable housing is not accessible if you have a wheelchair, for example. Most of the housing in Philadelphia that is aging old housing stock that is not energy efficient. Often it has lead and asbestos. So people who are already vulnerable are made even more vulnerable by the existing housing stock. We decided a few years ago to start working on building tiny houses for people exiting homelessness. And so what I've started first was to tour the world, to visit different villages of tiny houses and see what works and what doesn't work. I went out to, Eugene, Oregon and Portland, Oregon to visit the tiny house communities out there. I went to, I went to one in Edinburgh, Scotland. I actually went there, a number of times, because their housing project is similar to what we're working on. And so I've been going out there to learn best practices until the pandemic started, and then it became impossible to travel. But prior to that, I was going on this tour and also connecting with the people who run tiny house villages throughout the world. The tiny house village that operates, to end homelessness or to, you know, house people who are homeless. They have a network where they meet regularly on Zoom to share best practices. So I work with these people and learn, you know, what works, what doesn't work, what we can improve on. And then for the last few years, I've been working with the city to get the tiny house project off the ground. Most specifically with Alan Dom and Mark Squilla, but a number of other council members. And our intention was not, you know, to have sheds, but to have houses, a tiny house. There's technically a tiny house is under 400 square feet and has a bathroom and a kitchen. And so that's what our tiny houses will be. There is a code for it. It's in the it's International Building Code. It's called Appendix Q, which outlines exactly what a tiny house is and what a tiny house isn't. And so I didn't realize that. I just thought kind of a tiny house was a small house, but there's actually dimensions and it's laid out clearly what a tiny house is. So that's what we're trying to do in Philadelphia. Then over the summer, I was involved in the homeless encampments that were popping up over the summer. So I would go there regularly, first to volunteer and to connect with the people who were in the encampments and find out what they needed. And then early on, it was clear that the city was going to try to evict those encampments. And so I worked with my student, Delaney, at Villanova. Oh, now I'm in the law school at Villanova, which is very strange because I'm not a lawyer. But I am Villanova's anti-poverty fellow. I teach courses on poverty and policy at Villanova. And so I had a law student of mine who, she was also volunteering at the encampment. And together we crafted litigation to sue Philadelphia to stop it from evicting the encampments. That was an incredibly difficult and overwhelming process. We got a supervising attorney to help us, and then we served Philadelphia with an injunction to stop the evictions and a restraining order so that they could not evict and or hurt any of the people down in the encampment. Philadelphia, like other cities, spends millions of dollars on homeless sweeping out encampments, and the encampments are not effective. Because what happens when a city does a sweep is that the people in the encampment, they just set up somewhere else, but it doesn't solve anything. And often the people who are swept are, lose all of their belongings. So it can be very disruptive and sometimes traumatizing for people in the encampment, when the city does a sweep. So my student and I crafted the litigation. We then served the city. We sued the city. There was a court hearing. We had plaintiffs from the encampment, and that case went on for a while. And then, what happened is that the city entered negotiations with our team, and part of the negotiations was that the city was going to work to create a tiny house village. And so the RFP that the city put out recently came from the encampment negotiations that we were involved in. So, and in essence, we've been working with the city on the tiny house project for a few years now, and it was going to happen, but the negotiations just made it faster. It just fast-tracked the whole thing so that the city would be more, it would work quicker to make it happen. So then the city identified land with city council members. I took about half of city council out to Lancaster over the summer to tour tiny house manufacturing plants. So the people I took on the tour were Alan Dom, Mark Squilla, Jamie Gaudier, Helen Gim, and Kendra Brooks. So I took them to Lancaster, and we toured it. We talked to Jamie many times, and Jamie Gaudier is in West Philadelphia, and then worked with her office to identify land in West Philadelphia. And so that, her office identified the land, had created like three different possibilities for where a tiny house project would be. But I'd been connecting with her office for a while on the project. So then what happened is they put out the RFP, a request for proposals for people to build these tiny homes. My understanding is the Welcome Village applied for to get land in Northeast Philadelphia, and we applied for land in West Philadelphia. The city has not yet made an announcement about what's happening in West Philadelphia. So, and the process for deciding is different. So the project that's happening in Northeast is not housing, it's shelter, it's zoned as a shelter. And so because of that, the decision was made by the Office of Homeless Services, who's overseeing it as a shelter. In West Philadelphia, it's zoned as housing, and therefore the PRA, the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority, and the housing authorities are overseeing and deciding on the RFP over in West Philadelphia. So it's a different process because they're zoned differently and they're considered different projects because of what they're doing. So the one in Northeast is meant to be temporary, and the one in the in West Philadelphia is meant to be permanent. So that's what we have right now. We are in the process of getting sponsorship for the tiny home village. And we're working on a bunch of other initiatives though, because I wanna be very clear that tiny homes does not solve homelessness. In fact, most people who are becoming homeless today are families who tiny houses are not ideal for. And I think that we in Philadelphia, but elsewhere, disproportionately focus on single men. But that's actually a minority of the population of people experiencing homelessness. And the majority of people experiencing homelessness are actually people who are working, but they are not affording enough, their wages are not high enough for them to be able to afford housing in Philadelphia. And unless we address that issue, we won't really be doing anything about homelessness. So we as a country have more often than not focused on single men when it comes to homelessness, because that it is predominantly the population of people who are chronically homeless, and people who are chronically homeless make up about 15 to 20% of the whole population of people experiencing homelessness, but they also utilize about 90% of the system's resources. So it is most cost effective to work with people who are, you know, chronically homeless. However, people who are chronically homeless also are first in line for services. And so I have worked with a lot of people who are not chronically homeless, and they don't fall under the category. They don't have disabilities. They're not in active addiction. And they are often coached by their case managers to say that they are in active addiction or have mental illness so that they will be bumped up and offered more services. Because throughout the country and in Philadelphia, if you are not considered vulnerable enough, you are not eligible for most of the homeless help that's offered in Philadelphia. So that's a massive problem. Our project isn't just about tiny houses, because really we think that that's not a fix at all. That in order to fix the problem of homelessness, that takes systemic change and policy change. We believe in change in public housing. So we're also working with legislators to pass policy changes needed to address the actual root problem of homelessness and not just, you know, swing at the branches, because, you know, we as a country continue to fish people out of the water instead of going upstream and finding out, like, why are they falling in the water to begin with? So we thoroughly believe that we need to have a reckoning on why is homelessness increasing dramatically? Why don't we have enough inventory of affordable housing in Philadelphia and throughout the country? And why are people who are working multiple jobs not able to afford housing in this nation that's considered to be so wealthy? So those are some of the things that we're addressing. There's a lot of projects on our horizon. Tiny houses is one of them that we're excited about. We've been working on for years, but it's certainly not the only thing. And in my opinion, it's not even really the most important thing. It is important, more important than that is to address the structural systems, the policy change, and working with legislators and campaigns to really make sure that we as a nation are more equitable and are not allowing our brothers and sisters to enter into homelessness to begin with. So that's it. I know it was a lot of information, but I hope that it gave you a little context on who I am and what we're doing as a project. I might not have mentioned it, but the name of the project is SREHUP. It stands for Student Run Emergency Housing Unit of Philadelphia. And there's probably about 300 people who are part of the project to some capacity. We have a board of directors, we have a board of advisors, we have staff, we have a team of people who are working all the time on the project. These are people who themselves have lived experience of homelessness, have experienced poverty. We also have lawyers on the team. We have social workers and case managers and legislators. So we have a large team and a coalition, and we're always looking to build on it because we believe this is all hands on deck. And we need, we need a lot of people to be involved in this work. It's really important. And John, I'm grateful to you for the work that you do. I think that you're one of the people who are in the trenches, serving and being there for our neighbors. And I think that's what we really need to do. We need to wrap our arms around each other and take care of each other. And I see you doing that in the community all the time. So thank you, John, for that work that you do.
Wow, wonderful. Well, thank you so much.